Loving Heavenly Father, in the name of Lord Jesus Christ, our loving Savior, our very highly exalted Savior, we come at thy feet once again, humbling ourselves, to acknowledge that our sufficiency is in thee alone. We haven't come here to see a man, or hear a man. We only hear thee and see thee. Our time will be wasted if our eyes are upon any man. We humbly pray thou may make every eye to fix upon thee. We thank thee for thy desire and the heavenly plan to speak to us, mortal, foolish, weak human beings, from the heavenly throne, through thy word, by thy spirit, through thy messengers. We humbly request thee, whatsoever thou hast planned and purposed and desired from eternity, to accomplish among us in these few days of fellowship through the American Holy Convocation, be fully accomplished. Thy heart be fully satisfied. Whatever thou hast to say to us, be heard clearly. What thou hast to accomplish, be fully accomplished. What thou hast to do to us, be also done for thy glory. O Lord, we are needy people. To whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of life. We don't know what to say, but we commit and commend ourselves unto thee. Down with our hearts. We long to hear thee, long to be used of thee, long to see thee moving and working in the whole world in the end days. Do possess us completely and fill the whole building with thyself and thy glory and thy presence. And do allow the evening to pass by till thou hast done thy full work. By faith be enthroned the Lord Jesus Christ in our hearts, in our midst, as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. May the Lordship be fully acknowledged in all what we do or what we say. We hide ourselves on the cross and pray in thee name, Lord Jesus Christ, our highly exalted Savior. First book of Samuel, chapter 4, verse 22. And she said, First book of Samuel, chapter 4.
First Samuel, chapter 4, verse 22. And she said, the glory is departed from Israel, for the ark of God is taken.
Second Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 1.
Second Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 1. Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house.
For a purpose, the Spirit of God has brought these words to our attention from the beginning of this year's Holy Convocation. And I do pray whatsoever the Lord has in his mind to speak to us be heard by us clearly. Let me give unto us here to hear. Even though I can't speak very clearly myself, I do pray, Lord, may speak to me. Now somebody might wonder why I can't speak clearly. I was stutterer and stammerer. Could hardly speak before my conversion clearly. Very nervous and very shy and very backward. The word comes so far up to my throat. You won't go beyond that way. So I had to pray, Lord, touch my lips and touch my tongue and my throat. I can't speak. And Lord spoke to me in a very clear way to give my life for his service. As I mentioned, I was born again very clearly in the month of December 1929, roughly 50 years ago. That time I was totally blind spiritually. I had no idea whatsoever what the Bible is, what God's purpose is. The Lord has spoken to me. After my conversion, one day I went to a Christian service in Winnipeg, Canada, month of January, 1930. And one very tall gentleman, by name Mr. Flynn, railway police officer, good believer, He came and see me looking very lonely. He shook my hand. He had a very firm, strong hand. He cracked my bones. And said to me, "Brother, why don't you go to India and preach the gospel?" Never forgot those words. I said, "Mr. Flynn, I'm an engineer. I have spent so many years in studying engineering. And to make things worse, I stutter. I stammer. I can't speak clearly. I can't sing a note. I have no qualification to be a public speaker. Never done it in my life. I was in school and college, very, very shy, very backward. I could hardly stand before 20 people. My knees start shaking and see a crowd." So I said, "How can such a man be a public speaker?" He only smiled and went away. But for 2 years, these words came ringing in my ears. "Why don't you? Why don't you? Why don't you? Why don't you?" And I would say, very truthfully, "Oh Lord, I give thee a very solemn promise. I'll give all my income in thy service. I don't want even a single pie for my own personal needs. Please, I beg thee, do not make me a preacher. I am quite happy to give you all my money. I know the desire for myself. But I can't speak. I know my handicap." And Lord Krishna saying to me, "I do not want your money. I want you. I want you." It's very hard for him to believe and understand. Why does he want me? So worthless and useless. Lord knows better. My struggle in 1932, in the month of April, 4th April, early morning, 2:30, I yielded in Vancouver, Canada. I was with India at that time. I said, "Lord, even though I cannot understand, how can I be a speaker? I have no the least qualification to be a speaker, but I'm ready. I make no choice. I have no choice. You can send me anywhere, I'll go. Keep me anywhere, I'll stay. I'll never say, 'Lord, take me to some other place.' Maybe India, any country, any place of any kind. Very hard. Lord, you are my Lord." 4th April, 1932. Early morning, 2:30, to settle. Lord said to me, "I accept you for my service on 3 conditions." Now mind you, nobody ever spoke to me about these matters. Nobody ever even suggested to me to give my life a God service. He thought it would be wrong on my part. But that early morning, I heard these words: "Withdraw your claim from your property in Punjab or Pakistan." Now, we are 6 brothers in the family. I'm the eldest son. My father has a property in Pakistan, some houses and factories. Last said to me, "You withdraw your claim from your share of the property." And certainly, Lord said to me, "Do not whisper to any man, friend or relation, about your personal needs. Tell me about it. Either by him or by suggestion." And thirdly, "Do not make your own plan. Let me lead you day by day." I replied, "Lord, I agree. So settle." I never knew how to pray. First time I had to speak in a Vancouver church building, I was so nervous, holding Bible upside down. Just like this. My hand all shaking and couldn't understand what was there. I was pushed into ministry. So I cried out, "Oh Lord, have mercy upon me. Have mercy upon me. I don't know what to say and how to say. Can't even stand properly." I just moved the Bible, went on praying to see that day, like this. Yes, O Lord, he then speaks to me. "So kindly bear with me very patiently. I do my best to speak clearly. and speak slowly. I can't help it. Words won't come to me. Sometimes I might eat them up. But I believe from my heart, God has something to say to us in these few days through this well-known story of Hannah and Samuel and David and Solomon. I want you to write these words upon your heart. You may forget everything else. Just begin to pray. Oh Lord, make me a Hannah vessel. Make me a Samuel vessel. Make me a David vessel and Solomon vessel to show forth thy glory. Bring back thy departed glory. It is a very common prayer these days among God's people everywhere. Go to any part of India or any part of the world, you find among the believers very common prayer. Lord, send the revival. We are conscious something has gone wrong. Something is missing. Something lacking. Everywhere. We want something and we don't get the something. And that's how God gave me the message some time ago from these four books. I mentioned in the beginning itself, I repeat, though it comes for the first time. In Hannah, we learn how to pray to meet God's needs. This is one of the biggest needs today in every part of the world. Learning how to pray in the mind of God. How to pray as God's co-worker. Many people spend hours in other activities. They can sing beautifully. They can preach nicely. They can walk, do many hard jobs, whatever they may be, but cannot find time to pray sufficiently. They find it hard to pray long enough. Word won't come, thoughts won't come, thoughts are wandering. But I find that is the very first thing we have learned as God's co-workers. Lord Jesus Christ did not begin his ministry by sermons. As you see, Gospel of St. Luke, and 3rd chapter, verse 31. Good Gospel, 3rd chapter.
Luke Gospel, chapter 3, verse 21. Luke's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 21. Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened.
He knew that phrase, and praying. Till that day, Lord Jesus Christ had not performed even a single miracle anywhere. And John the Baptist says, in John Gospel, chapter 1, verse 33, John Gospel, chapter 1, verse 33.
John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 33. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost.
Even John the Baptist did not know who he was till the day of his baptism. And Lord Jesus Christ, till that day, had not given a single message anywhere. That's what we know. Had not performed any miracle anywhere. But he began by prayer. And he showed us in a simple way. He came in the world and learned how to pray to see heaven open. And three things happened when the Lord prayed. We read that also. Luke 3, verse 21.
Luke's Gospel, chapter 3, reading verse 21 again. Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened. And verse 22, and the Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape like a dove upon him, and a voice came from heaven which said, Thou art my beloved Son, indeed I am well pleased.
When he prayed, and that day, three things happened. First of all, heaven opened. Secondly, the Holy Ghost came. Thirdly, the voice came. And that should be our daily experience. And whatever has happened to our Lord, whatever He has done Himself, it happened for our own edification. He has no need to pray. God to do a new work in our midst, and the whole world, let us learn how to pray. Pray till heavens are open. Not mere repetition of names and phrases and lectures in sermon. Pray by faith. And see God's power coming like a flood upon us. God's voice, the loving voice, the still small voice, heard very clearly. And then you find through lifetime, your life of Lord Jesus Christ, the life of prayer. It began by prayer, you saw that on Tuesday evening, all the verses. And now, we are reading about the Hannah. She was very hard, unanswered woman. Very God-fearing woman. And for a purpose, God kept her waiting for the child. God can never make a mistake. Whatsoever God does, He does it for a purpose. His ways are past finding out. His ways are higher in our ways. Isaiah 55 and verse 8. It's past in our thoughts.
Book of Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord.
At the same time, we also know, as for God, His way is perfect. Psalm 18, verse 30. Psalm 18, verse 30.
Psalm 18,
verse 30 through 0.
Psalm 18, verse 30. As for God, His way is perfect. The word of the Lord is tried. He is a buckler to all those that trust in Him.
His way is perfect. And verse 32, same Psalm, Psalm 18, verse 32.
Psalm 18, verse 32. It is God that girdeth me with strength and maketh my way perfect.
Maketh my way perfect. Whatever happened to us in our lifetime by our loving Savior happens to bring us in His perfect way. It's for that purpose God has kept Hannah waiting for a child, to bring her in His perfect way as a pardoned co-worker. We saw that evening, she prayed earnestly. She prayed in tears. She prayed to get burdened and travail. O Lord, have mercy upon me. Take away my reproach. Take away my barrenness. Meet my need. Make me happy. Answer my prayer, not my request. Help me in my reproach. God is silent. Not because He is punishing her, but unknown to her, Lord bringing her into a partnership. He depends upon you and me as His co-workers. As you said again and again, and repeated again and again. Nowhere in the Bible we ever read angels being called God's co-workers. You can go through the whole Bible, from Genesis to Revelation. You won't come across a single verse, or a fragment. The angels, the mighty angels, you see in Psalm 103 and verse 20. Psalm 103, verse 20.
Psalm 103,
verse 20.
Verse 20. Bless the Lord, ye His angels, that excel in strength, that do His commandments, hearkening unto the voice of His word.
They are mighty angels. They hearken unto the voice of God. They are not rebellious, not stubborn, not disobedient. Yet, they are never called as God's co-workers. They remain our ministering spirit. Or we have Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 13 and 14. Hebrews chapter 1.
Hebrews chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. But to which of the angels said He at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation?
The angels are our ministering spirits, our servants. Serve us. Look after us. Take care of us. Be at our service. The mystery. So I believe God was bringing Hannah into a partnership with Himself. Hannah thought in the beginning, Her own need was very great. And that's why she wept and prayed. God was saying, Hannah, how about my need? I also want something. Mighty God, the great God, who is way the past finding out, depending upon you and me, for his people. The weak people who are his need. Can we say, my life will be so lived, I am meeting God's need. God has got some need. God wanted a vessel. In those days, there was a great spiritual darkness in the country because of sin in the house of God. God was being robbed. God's glory was being robbed by these men of high priests and their servants. We mentioned how many people came eagerly from many far off places and brought their sacrifices to be offered in the house of God. They were the servants of the sons of Eli, going about with a flesh hook of three teeth. You see there also? 1 Samuel and 2nd chapter.
1 Samuel chapter 2.
From 12th verse.
Reading from verse 12. Now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. They knew not the Lord.
Verse 13.
And the priest's custom with the people was that when any man offered sacrifice, the priest's servant came while the flesh was in seething with a flesh hook of three teeth in his hand, and he stuck it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot. All that the flesh hook brought up the priest took for himself. So they did in Shiloh and to all the Israelites that came thither. Also before they burned the fat, the priest's servant came and said to the man that sacrificed, give flesh to roast for the priest, for he will not have sodden flesh of thee, but raw. And if any man said unto him, let them not fail to burn the fat presently, and then take as much as thy soul desireth, then he would answer him, nay, but thou shalt give it me now, and if not, I will take it by force.
I will take it by force. The happening house of God, the servants are the sons of the high priest saying these words, take it by force. The people, the devotion and sacrifice, and come all the way, long distances, to offer these sacrifices. All these sacrifices are a shadow of the sacrifice of Lord Jesus Christ. And by force, with the help of a flesh hook of three teeth, like this, they grabbed everything and took it away, robbing God of his portion. What a sin. And same thing is happening today among God's servants, in God's house, among God's people. They are using these flesh hook of three teeth to rob God. What are these three teeth? Love for money, love for power, love for fame and name. These are three great flesh of teeth working today among God's people, among God's servants, doing much for money's sake, never satisfied, telling false stories to get more money, telling fear to get more money, putting on torn shoes to have more money, putting on torn clothes to have more money, looking miserable to have more money, never satisfied, and making many very strong appeal, give liberally. I remember many years ago, heard a message from God's servant over radio. He said, gentlemen, we are going to have a banquet for young people. And he said, we need $10,000 for that banquet. Please give liberally. If you won't do so, we will be in a hole. Now you to say, in America, you find somebody in a hole every day. They are in a hole on Sunday, in a hole on Monday, hole on Tuesday, hole on Wednesday, hole to next Sunday. What a shame. Making God a beggar. He's not a beggar. The living God, the mighty God, who says, open thy mouth wide, I will fill it. Psalm 81 verse 10. Not before men, before God.
Psalm 81
and verse 10.
Verse 10. I am the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Open thy mouth wide, and I will fill it.
I will fill it. God says, I'll fill it. God can fill us. And God told me, in the beginning itself, I thank God for the message. Never whisper, never tell to any human being about your personal need of any kind. A doubt came to me only two occasions. As I began my ministry in Karachi in 1933, I had no proper meal, food for about 2 or 3 months. One day I felt very hungry. That was in 1933, more than 46 years ago. A thought came to me. My friend take a lunch at 1 o'clock or 1:15. I'll go at 1:30. They sure to say, have something to eat. I'll say, no, thank you twice. And yes, thank you third time. So I walked in. Exactly at 1:30. Come in. Have something to eat. No, thank you. After a few minutes, why don't you have a little? No, thank you. Third time, oh, have something. Thank you very much. Had a very good meal. Again, after a few weeks, the same thought came. I'll go at 1:30. And say, no, thank you twice. And yes, thanks third time. On the way, Lord put my ear. And said to me, where your faith? I said, Lord, I never asked for food. They asked me. I said, no twice. But Lord said to me, very clearly, what was your motive in going over there? I'll put to shame. It's the only time in the past 47 years a doubt came. Otherwise, I say to God's glory, he has met every need. There's no hint of any kind. No letter, no camera, we have no camera. No camera, no photo, no tears, no torn shoes. Jesus Christ, living Savior. Why doubt him? The first truth is love for money. Second truth, love for power, authority. We want to be governors of God's law, not servants. And third truth is love for name, love for fame. And that's why we don't see today many who are worthy to be called God's servants. They are money servants, not God's servants. But money says they do it. There's more money they'll go. Similarly, they glorify man too much. I fear of America. They magnify man so much, say I, drop him of the crowd, come here so and so. We cannot rob God and be guiltless. That's because you see people, men going out, they see you, the glory departed. Glory departed. At the same time, sin came in the house of God. And verse 22. First Samuel, second chapter, verse 22.
First Samuel chapter 2, verse 22. Now Eli was very old, and heard all that his sons did unto all Israel, and how they lay with women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation.
Sin has entered in the house of God, in many certain ways. It's happening today. Go to many Bible schools in America, Bible colleges, and how they behave there among themselves. I have seen them behaving shamefully in a public meeting even. No sense of shame. In India, we have to bend our head with shame and saw the American women half naked. Don't tell me, please, is our culture. It's not a culture. It is sin responsible for the naked bodies, not culture. When people in Africa, women were naked, we would say, uncivilized African. When American women naked, new culture. American culture. Oh, What a spiritual barrenness we are coming to.
How low is our standard of Christianity in the name of culture and custom and traditions. God's word can never change. Our Lord can never change. God waited patiently. He is so long-suffering. He is so patient. He is so loving and kind. He is so faithful. So gracious. He waits and He waits and He waits and He waits. But we don't repent, He must punish. The time came, the glory departed. God's word became precious. What a sad condition of God's people. Today in many places one could see the word Ichabod about to come outside grand building. Beautiful building. Pastor has got many degrees, PhD and MD. But inside death reigns. Singing with no joy. Sermon full of words, no message. People go empty and come empty. Then glory departed. Now, for God has purpose, it must come to pass. As you see in Malachi chapter 3 verse 6, Malachi chapter 3 verse 6.
Book of Malachi chapter 3 verse 6. Book of Malachi, chapter 3, verse 6. For I am the Lord, I change not.
I am the Lord, I change not. We may change. Our Lord can never change. What He has purpose must come to pass. He has desired to give us all that He has. That heavenly plan. That's why He gave the first man, Adam, dominion, power and authority for the whole creation. As Genesis chapter 1. And the verse 26. Book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 26.
Book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth.
To show His love for the first man, Adam, God gave him a birthday gift. We become mature after many years. But Adam, he was born mature. God word says so. God is saying, my son Adam, I have got for you very nice birthday gift. Loving gift. Gift, yes. Adam was very anxious and told, Adam, now I give you dominion. Power, authority for the whole creation. You command any bird, they come to you. Command any fish, they'll come to you. Just as the Lord just said, He gave a command in John Gospel and chapter 20. John Gospel, chapter 20.
John Gospel, chapter 20.
John Gospel and chapter 20. Sorry, chapter 21.
John's Gospel, chapter 21.
From verse 3.
Reading from verse 3. Simeon Peter said unto them, I go a fishing. They say unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately. And that night they caught nothing. But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said unto them, children, have you any meat? They answered him, no. And when he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Therefore that disciples whom Jesus loved said unto Peter, it is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girt his fisher's coat unto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea. And the other disciples came in a little ship, for they were not far from the land, but as it were 200 cubits, dragging the net with fishes. As soon as they were come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid thereon and bread. Jesus said unto them, Bring of the fish which ye have now caught.
11.
Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land full of great fishes, and 153. And for all there were so many, yet was not the net broken.
153 great fishes, and net not a break. Imagine early morning, by Lake Tiberias, largely standing there on the shore, and the disciples looking very tired, empty boat, empty stomach, but very miserable. The Lord said, Children, have ye any meat? Nothing. Not even tiny fish. The Lord says, Fishes, I'm your creator, come to me. And they began to move straight away. Now the fishes mixed together. Large fishes, medium size, and small size. Don't live separately. All live together, you find them. Second command, fishes, I only want big fishes. Small ones and medium, right about her. They turned back. A lot said so. Third command, fishes, come in a queue, make a line. Because the big fishes, as they come together, they struggle, won't they? And it's a bigger net. So he says, and the net did not break. Why? Because the fishes came one by one, orderly way, the proper way. No struggle, no striving. My point is, largest size has power over the fishes, over the birds, over the animals. And the same power was given to Adam also. It's because of sin. Because of sin, disobedience, Adam lost that privilege. God gave the gift of love, dominion, power, authority over the whole creation. He was a unique king. King over the birds and the fishes and the animals and the creatures. But Adam lost, and the Lord recovers by obedience. Oh, that's why the Lord came, to recover. And he wants you and me to be a co-worker with him, the recovery. He could not himself, wanted to. But he has not given that privilege to the angels, you and even me. And that's why I believe God was waiting. So one day, Hannah began to think, why is it? Lord does not answer my prayer. I have fasted and prayed, put everything right. I have shed tears. I love him. I follow him. I obey him.